اوكي، السلام عليكم. I'm Bikram Muntada. I'm a gastroenterologist, hepatologist, and hepatobiliary interventionist. Welcome to you in this first lecture of the GIT. It is entitled about the esophagus. We are welcome to meet you in this class, and I hope to meet you all soon after the end of this pandemic. So we will start. Our first lecture is about the esophagus. The objective of this lecture is to know what is GERD. At the end of this lecture, everyone from you must know what is GERD, what is this complication, how we diagnose GERD, and how we manage this complication. The most important complication of GERD is the esophagitis, barrett esophagus. We know how we diagnose the esophagitis, barrett esophagus, and what is motility disorders of the esophagus, and what are the tumors of the esophagus. Simply, the esophagus is a muscular tube. It's a hollow viscous. Its function is to connect the oropharynx to the stomach. Its average length is about 27 centimeters. The esophagus is longer in a male compared with the female. Even if the female is taller than the male, her esophagus is shorter than the female. Regarding the anatomy, it consists of very important, we know the anatomy of the esophagus. The upper one-third of the esophagus is a striated muscle. So if it is a striated muscle, this means that it is under some sort of voluntary control. The distal two-thirds of the esophagus, it consists of smooth muscle. So it is under the involuntary control, mainly visceral nerves that is distributed between the layers of the muscle of the esophagus, and mainly is that come from the vagus nerve. Important to know the histology of the esophagus. The upper one-third of the esophagus, it is stratified and keratinized epithelium, while that of the distal esophagus is that of columnar epithelium, and this is very important regarding the pathology of the development of the diseases and disorders of the esophagus.
Yeah, Guru.
أيوبي
روباي
حبيبي حتى سي دكتور عطل.
الحضور يعني تبدا عليه مباح الوزاره كل شيء سواء الحضور بالتفاعل الالكتروني.
لا هسه واضحه السلايدات؟
هذا ماكو ست
بثلاث قرون.
So rapidly, we will review what we talk. The esophagus is a muscular tube. It connects the oropharynx to the stomach. Simply, it is the passage of the food from the oropharynx to the stomach. But merely, this is not the real of the esophagus. The esophagus is a vital organ. It has a multiple complex movement, multiple complex functions. Loss of these functions result in dislodgement of food in the upper part of the chest, in the mediastinum, and development of the complication. Then in muscular skeletal of the esophagus, upper one third is skeletal, distal one third is smooth muscle. The mucosa of the esophagus is that of the stratified, non-keratinized epithelium. The distal esophagus at the gastroesophageal junction, it is an overlap with columnar epithelium. With development of complication, this mucosa will change. There is some sort of function or presence of this type of mucosa. The stratified mucosa and non-keratinized epithelium is usually part of function. The esophagus, there's different type of food that are acidic, alkaline, hot, very cold, so it must be protected. So the function of this mainly is that of a protective mechanism. The other part of the esophagus, histologically, the esophagus differs from other part of the gastrointestinal tract. It devoid serosa. It has mucosa, submucosa, and muscularis mucosa, and there is no serosa. It's not lined by the serosa. And again, we told important symptoms of the esophageal disorders, heartburn. The heartburn, it is the cardinal symptom of the esophageal disorders. Simply, heartburn is a substernal burning sensation. Other symptoms, it is very important, is that of the chest pain. Due to presence of multiple organs in this area, extending in the mediastinum, in the upper part of the chest, including vital and life-threatening organs like heart, lung, bronchi, blood vessels, important blood vessels like the aorta and its tributaries and its branches. So all these organs have common innervation and the same size and nearby structures. So the chest pain, important to differentiate the esophageal type of chest pain from that of aortic type, myocardial ischemia, and that of the respiratory system. For example, if it is a central heavy chest pain, mainly radiating to the jaw, to the left shoulder, this is part of myocardial ischemia. If it is a stabbing type of pain, this is the pleural, as simple as that. If it is a tearing, like a tear, and it is radiated to the interscapular area, this is part of the aortic dissection. That of the esophageal type of pain, mainly it is a central, most likely it is related to the food. Mainly it is related to the inclination. If the patient is supine position, there is a chest pain due to regurgitation of some acidic. If it is go to a sitting position, there is some sort of a relieving pain. But it is very difficult to differentiate chest pain of that of the esophageal from that of the myocardial ischemia mainly. Even if we take a medication, nitrate, it induces dilatation of the coronaries and also that of the smooth muscles of the esophagus. The other important is that of the dysphagia. Dysphagia is a difficulty in swallowing. And dysphagia is very important to differentiate because it gives a hint what is the pathology in the esophagus. Logically, dysphagia to start to what type of food from the start? Is to solid. If it is a percent dysphagia to start to a solid part of the food, this is mainly related to a structural disease. Structural disease usually causing a dysphagia to a solid. While if it is started to both solid and liquid, on the staff, or it is to a liquid on the staff. This is mainly goes with a motility disorders of the esophagus, achalasia, and other motility disorders. Very important is to know the neurological type of dysphagia, because the upper part of the esophagus is under the control of cranial nerves. So if a patient develops, for example, a cerebrovascular accident, CVA, stroke, there is a loss of cranial nerve path, this will develop what we call oropharyngeal dysphagia, transfer dysphagia. The patient will have difficulty lodging of the food bolus from the mouth to the oropharynx. يعني شنو المريض مثلا ما يقدر يبلع اللبن ما يبلع لذا شنو شو يصير عنده وياه ويا الديسبيجيا ممكن يصير عنده وياه regurgitation nasal regurgitation because of the loss of closure of the nasal passages. The patient will develop cough due to aspiration because the nasopharynx will not be closed and the uvula will not close the respiratory passage, so food goes to the bronchi and it will irritate the bronchi. So the dysphagia on the esophagus, we must know if it is distal part of the dysphagia, this is mainly goes with structural. If it is started to liquid and solid, this is mainly goes with motility disorders of the esophagus. Another important symptom is that of odynophagia. Odynophagia is a painful swallowing. Usually it is that of a presence of ulceration in the esophagus, whether infectious, corrosive drugs, cause odynophagia. It's very painful sensation, that of odynophagia. The patient cannot even swallow the saliva. So it is, if you see a patient with odynophagia, you will know what he is suffering from. Regurgitation. Regurgitation is usually that of the presence of some sort of laxity in the lower part of the esophagus. This allows reflux of gastric content to the esophagus, and after that to the mouth. A lot of pathology can cause regurgitation, but the cardinal is that of motility disorder with a huge dilatation of the esophagus as we see it in the patient with achalasia. Food impaction, it is considered as an emergency, the same as dysphagia. When a patient develops a structural defect in the esophagus, for example, the presence of a mass in the esophagus, this will close the esophagus. Patient take a food bolus, it will completely close the esophagus. This will cause distension of the esophagus. And the pain receptors in the gastrointestinal tract, it will be dictated by distension. And the LM is still right in the gastrointestinal tract. A lot of one of them, if we pull the bowel, it will induce pain. If we distend the bowel, including the esophagus, it will cause pain. إذا احنا مثلا من نشتغل مثلا بالجاسترونتستاينا او البوليب او شيء انقصته ما يحس المريض باي الم، او مرات مثلا نفتح بيه فتحه ما يحس بالم. يحس بالم المريض بالديستنشن ريسبتورز، يعني اذا صار عنده ديستنشن، واذا صار وي ويل بول ذا باور ويل كوز بين، اوكي؟ Food impaction is considered as an emergency, must be treated appropriately, it will may cause perforation, mediastinitis, and even death. Disorders of the esophagus, the cardinal disorders of the esophagus is GERD. GERD simply is the reflux of gastric content from the stomach to the esophagus. What is the epidemiology? Epidemiology, it is usually, I ask you, GERD, where is common? Here or in the Western countries? What do you think? No, the Western countries. ليش؟ لأن هي إلها علاقة بالtype of food we eat it and with the diet habit and with westernization of the diet habit, with westernization of the lifestyle, the GERD in our community raised. It is mainly the GERD related to the type of meal we eat, that of high lipid called relaxation, high taking of chocolate substances called relaxation of the lower esophagus, and the obesity. Obesity is an important cause of the GERD because it results in loss, what we call in physiological sphincters, and anatomical disruption of the lower esophageal sphincter. واحد يصير سمين شلون lower esophagus بها angulation. It's a type of bulb allow the passage of food from the esophagus to the stomach and prevent it from return back. Really, every person, every person have some sort of jerk, but we don't have a symptom of jerk. That is why the esophagus have a protective mechanism from the development of jerk symptom. What are these protective mechanisms? One is the motility of the esophagus. It is motile rapidly. Two, the presence of the lower esophageal sphincter. It acts as a physiological and anatomical sphincter. Third, it is very important, is the epithelium of the esophagus. And four is the presence of a saliva from the mouth. It neutralizes the acid. فكل واحد من عندنا هو عنده some sort of reflux. Normally, the lower esophageal sphincter, there is what we call the transient lower esophageal sphincter relaxation. It is a part of few seconds. In these few seconds, if you are obese, تصعد الريجرجيتيشن. If you have a disease of the lower esophagus, تصعد. إذا أنت نايم وبكيت وصارت the transient normal physiology, the transient lower esophageal sphincter relaxation. And إذا ظلت contracted, راح تنتج عنها disease الثانية. يعني هو مسدود وراح يتحرك. As a dilatation of the esophagus and loss of smooth muscle power. But simply, it is a regurgitation of the gastric content into the esophagus. Other important is what we call hiatal hernia. Hiatal hernia, what is the hiatal hernia? Hiatal hernia is the, this is the perineal of the hiatus hernia, and this is the demonstration of hiatus hernia. Simply, hiatus hernia is the herniation of the stomach above the gastroesophageal junction. This is the gastroesophageal junction. This is okay. Normally, ماكو هذه البلج. هذا stomach. Herniation of the stomach. أول شيء من يصير herniation of the stomach, we lose the normal physiological and anatomical sphincter that protect the esophagus from the reflux of the gastric content. Either is the stomach upper part in the in the body, and it is, this is some sort of acid in the chest. So the most important risk factor for GERD is that of the diet habit, high chocolate, high fat. Two, those of the protective mechanisms of the lower esophageal sphincter is that of obesity and hiatus hernia. Very important, diet habit, hiatus hernia, and obesity. Clinical manifestation. Clinical manifestation of GERD, the cardinal, what do you think? The cardinal symptom. GERD. Chunishki. Sorry. Yes, heartburn. Heartburn is the cardinal symptom. Retrosternal chest pain, or acidic. Yes, acidic in the chest. Other symptoms the patient can develop chest pain. Why patients develop chest pain in the setting of the GERD? لا because of spasm. هو مو يجي له acid فهو ما متعود الإسوفيجس على الأسيديتي هو متعود شنو الكلام الإسوفيجس فمين جت له أسيديتي من الستومك يعني استغرب شلون مثلا واحد بيجي له بالستيملس يشكيش هو الإسوفيجس ما عنده يسوي contraction. Contraction it will induce pain, spasm. أي مكان يصير فيه spasm مو يصير pain. Okay. Simply, as simple as that, how we diagnose GERD. The GERD is usually diagnosed depending on the clinical manifestation. And يجي لنا المريض شو يقول؟ يقول عندي اني يسموها محموره او جالي مثلا هم يقولوها بالعاميه. He feel some sort of retrosternal burning sensation. This is retrosternal burning sensation not related to the heavy exercise, not related to climbing stairs. It is usually related to type of meal, it is usually related to the day and time during the day, mainly at night when the patient is inclining. This is typical symptoms of GERD. If we have a typical symptoms of GERD and the patient not have a risk factors will be alarming symptoms. يعني جانا المريض typical GERD symptom وما عنده يسمونها alarming symptoms يعني شيء تحذيري. Have it diagnosed on a clinical background. This is a GERD and we treat him. Okay? So, معناته إذا المريض عنده alarming symptom, لازم نروح للinvestigation. So, what do you think the alarming symptoms in a patient with GERD? I will tell you. If the patient is developed dysphagia, develop odynophagia, the patient develops significant weight loss, develop gastrointestinal bleeding, يعني hematemesis, vomiting of the blood, or meningitis, black stool. You know these terms. Then when عملين كمان. If the patient have a family history of esophageal or gastric tumor. If the patient non-responding to empirical treatment, this is indication for investigation. Okay. What are the investigations we do? First, we do an OGD. OGD هو esophageal gastroduodenoscope, هذا scope. And what is the importance of the OGD in a patient with GERD? Firstly, to look for the development of complications. Additionally, OGD in a patient with GERD, normal. GERD, the OGD مالته normal. لكن إذا دخلنا وشفنا some sort of ulceration, this is confirmed the development of GERD. The most important complication of GERD is esophagitis. Esophagitis, erosive type of esophagitis. شوف ulcers. The lower part of the esophagus. يعني معناته شنو هذا؟ معناته اكو acidity. هذا confirm this is a GERD. Okay? So we need OGD to confirm the diagnosis of GERD, looking for the complication of GERD, and to exclude other diagnoses, مثلا tumor, مثلا ecclesia. Okay? And the cardinal, if the patient is non responding, يعني سوينا له OGD شنو طلع ال OGD مالته normal هو عنده cardinal symptom of GERD ونطيناه treatment وهماتين ما صار زين ال next step شنو نسوي له برأيكم؟ يعني هو acidity أو فد شيء هذا نسوي له pH monitoring شنو pH monitoring؟ both دخلوا من الماوث أو النوز خلي بالجاسترو إيسوفيجيال جنكشن عنده either fluoroscope يعني أشعة أشعة طالعة خلي بالجاسترو إيسوفيجيال جنكشن عادة for 24 hours وبي يعني فد شيء هنا يخلوا للمريض اللي هو يسمونه هذا يعني ينقل القراءات مالته المشاهدات يسجل تاخذها ورا 24 ساعة وتشوف البروب شنو قرا يقرا لك اسيديتي جلد الاسيديتي اكو اسيديك جاي تصعد عنده او لا كل ما يحس مثلا صار عنده سيمبتوم اوف جير يسجلها مثلا الساعة بالعشرة صارت عنده اتاك اوف جير الساعة بالعشرة اتاك اوف جير فمن نجي نخليها هو فلاش تخليه هنا بالكمبيوتر وتباوع مثلا الساعة بالعشرة هو مو قايل باوع الساعة بالعشرة ومباوع للقراءة اذا القراءة مالتها صحيح اكو اسيديتي صاعدة معناته هذا confirm the diagnosis of GERD. So the investigation of GERD OGD include the diagnosis and next is the pH monitoring. pH monitoring هو يسمونه pH monitoring with impedance. Impedance شنو فائدته؟ مرات مو بس الاسيديك هي تسوي GERD. من اسيديك اللي هي شنو ممكن؟ بنكرياتي جوز او بليري سكريشن. هم معك يعني نعرف السبب مالته. Treatment. So, what do you think the treatment of GERD? Firstly, is that of lifestyle modification. And that's mean what up. If I eat the food daily, for example, from 10 to 11 daily, I eat, for example, شغلات كثيرة, تمن, مثلا, مرقة, I eat it. يعني هذا يتغير lifestyle modification. Exercise, I'm losing weight. الأشياء اللي تسوي relaxation of lower esophageal sphincter يبتعد عنها. اللي هي mainly lipid and part of the مثلا chocolate substances. Try to avoid it. Okay. If lifestyle modification not worthy, so the next step we go to the pharmacological. And the cornerstone of treatment of pharmacological treatment is the proton pump inhibitor, PPI. Okay. It is يسمونها anti-secretory drugs. Anti-secretory drugs to H2 blockers and PPI. PPI is superior to H2 blockers, and usually we give the treatment for about 8 to 12 weeks. And the patient, if the patient is responding, try to reduce the dose to the lowest effective dose. مرات المريض يبقى طول عمره على PPI ما يقدر يقطع. بتقطعه صار عنده جل. Okay. Important to know how we take the PPI. Usually we take the dose half to 1 hour before meal. And if he needs a second dose, he takes it before dinner. يعني ياخذها الصبح قبل نص ساعة إلى ساعة قبل الغيوب لازم. على مود تشتغل. Then insertion of the proton pump here during the active state. يعني من ياكل يصير insertion عم يصير لها بلوك. The half to 1 hour على ما يشتغل هو واذا احتاج دوز ثاني نعطيها الى قبل الحشو. اوكي سو اف ذا بيشنت also in responding to medical treatment, will the patient responding to medical treatment. The next step, we have a route for surgery. And what is the type of surgery? Type of surgery, this is in a route, someone in icing conduplication. It is, we do a tightening of the lower esophagus. And the indication for surgery in a patient with jerk, here refractory medically and responding jerk, the mama respond to jerk. Near, مريض مثلا يقول اني ما اقدر يعني ادفع فلوس مال بي بي اي طول عمري سوي لها جمع الفلوس سوي لها عمليه وخلص منها مو صح؟ A patient he want a surgery because of the long term treatment. ثلاثه the patient develop side effect of medication ومرضى ما يتحملون البي بي اي صار عندهم side effect and for correction of hypertension. So this is the indication of surgical treatment in a GERD patient. Important complication, the indication of GERD. The importance of a GERD, not because of the bothersome symptom of a GERD. The importance of the GERD is in its complication. Its complication can be life-threatening and fatal. The most important complication of GERD is esophagitis. Esophagitis, the erosive type of esophagitis. Two is the development of Barrett esophagus and adenocarcinoma of the esophagus and development of anemia. And the fourth thing is the development of a stricture. Stricture, this is because of the rapid reflux of gastric content, the esophagus will change the epithelium, will injury to the muscle, and the muscle will be replaced by a fibrous tissue. So this results in a stricture of the esophagus, benign stricture of the esophagus. Esophagitis, simply, what is esophagitis? Esophagitis, it is, what do you think the diagnosis of esophagitis, the term esophagitis? The term esophagitis is an endoscopic term. يعني مثلا ما يصير واحد هو يقول عندي heartburn شو تقول له انت عندك التهاب المريء. هذا اللي عنده heartburn شو نقول له عندك استرجاع، مو صح؟ ممكن اذا نسوي له OGB يطلع لنا ورطه، هذه يسمونها erosive gel. بس متى ما سوينا له OGB هو عنده typical GERD symptom ولقينا evidence of esophagitis يعني ulceration in the lower part of the esophagus. This is called esophagitis. So the esophagitis it is a endoscopic term. That's right. The treatment of esophagitis the same as the treatment of GERD. But our goal in esophagitis is the healing of the esophagitis. While our goal in the treatment of GERD is the relief of symptoms and the prevention of a complication of GERD. Okay? لازم تطيب الاسوفاجيتس. لأن إذا ما طابت راح تصير complication. Other complication, important complication of the GERD is Barrett esophagus. Barrett esophagus, simply, the lower part of epithelium of the esophagus is replaced by the columinal type of epithelium. And you know how you know this is a simple stratified epithelium from the columinal epithelium? What is the cardinal histological finding in columinal epithelium? That is a specialized type of columinal epithelium. In the lower part of the esophagus, you have the overlap between the gastroesophageal junction and columinal. So what is the cardinal? It's the presence of goblet cell. لازم من تاخذ يعني من بارك اسوفاجاس it is a histological diagnosis. يسمون اسوفاجاتس قلنا endoscopic diagnosis هذا histological diagnosis. Histological diagnosis تاخذ biopsy ودي histopathology والhistopathology هنا لازم نلقى يعني normal simple stratified epithelium ايش راح نلقى؟ specialized type of columinal epithelium لازم بي goblet cell على مود نقول هذا شنو؟ intestinal metaplasia. So the Barrett esophagus is the intestinal metaplasia of the lower part of the esophagus, and it is an histological diagnosis. هو هذا simply هذا normal esophagus. شوف شلون حلو هذا متغير هذا normal وهذا اللي يسمونه salmon color esophagus. شايفين السلمون؟ قبل ما كان موجود هسه موجود نفس هذا لونه سالمون كلر هذا معناته intestinal metabolism. هذا بارك إيسوفيغس. This is a بارك إيسوفيغس. This is histological. عم بين هنا أكو goblet cell. Goblet cell شلون تبين هنا؟ This is the بطل الجديد. This is the بطل الجديد. As in connection, هي شنو بيها goblet cell؟ بيها mucus. فمن يصبغوها شنو؟ mucus يدوب بيطلع لونها أبيض. أوكي؟ فهي خلايا ذن يعني ألوان. هي شنو الخلايا؟ هي ديوكسين هي ماكروكسين يصبغوا. فكلهم لو تبيها لو أزرق لو شنو؟ لو بينك لو أحمر. فتجين بيناتهم هيش دوائر بيض. هي دوائر البيض هي goblet cells. And what are the risk factors for the bark esophagus? The most important is GERD. GERD is a risk factor for the development of bark esophagus. And the most important in GERD is the duration of GERD. يعني مثلا واحد عنده duration of GERD صار له 3 سنوات، واحد عنده صار له 10 سنوات. طبعا the risk of bark esophagus with that of 10 years is more than. The most important is the duration of the GERD. Usually, the risk is starting after 5 years of untreated GERD. The patient will develop bark esophagus. Okay, other male, age more than 50 years, white, Caucasian. This is our risk factors for the development of the bark esophagus. White, Caucasian, male, age more than 50, presence of prolonged duration of untreated GERD. Simply, how we diagnose the bark esophagus? Endoscopy, and we take a multiple biopsies. Multiple biopsies and in protocol type of biopsies. مو random. We have اسمعهن يعني ناخذ ده تعرفوها. ناخذ biopsies send for histopathology. إذا اجتنا ال result مال histopathology it is just شنو الهدف؟ شلون تجينا ال result مال histopathology؟ إما just bark esophagus معناته هذا بس intestinal metabolism. أو تجي وياها شنو؟ with dysplasia. تعرفون شنو الفرق بين metabolism و dysplasia؟ أول مرة normals. نبتجي ميتابليزيا اللي هي يعني البدايه، نبتجي ديسبليزيا، ديسبليزيا اللي هي لو جريد، ميديوم وهاي جريد، عاده ميديوم تنشال، انترميديت يسمونها، بس لو جريد وهاي جريد ديسبليزيا، نو كارسينوما انسايتو، نو كانسر، نو انفيزيف كارسينوما، هو هذا السيكونس اوف تيومروجينيسيس، اوكي؟ فاذا اجت لنا بس انتستاينال ميتابليزيا هذا بارد ايسوفيغاس، اوكي؟ اذا اجت وياها ديسبليزيا معناتها ويا المرات هي overlapping Barrett esophagus with dysplasia. So how we treat a patient with the Barrett esophagus? We treat it same as a patient with GERD. Treat him by BBI, anti-secretory drugs. Anti-secretory drug قلنا تشمل ممكن proton pump inhibitor, H2 blocker. But the BBI is severe to H2 blocker. So treatment of Barrett esophagus is by anti-secretory drug, mainly BBI. لكن do you think that the patient, if we treat it with BBI, this will prevent the progression or halt the progression of Barrett esophagus to dysplasia? No. Nor medical treatment, nor surgical treatment will halt the progression or the development of invasive carcinoma. So what is the benefit of the BBI? The benefit of the BBI is to prevent another attack of Barrett esophagus. Next step, and finally has the BBI, جانا result بس بارك إيسوفيغاس, final treatment BBI. Not important, احنا بالOGD نحسب ايش قد اللينك ماتل بارك إيسوفيغاس. If it is less than 3 cm or if it is more than 3 cm. If it is less than 3 cm, we do a screening, يعني نقول له يجينا ورا فترة نسوي له OGD. وإذا أقل أكثر من 3 نقول له ورا فترة يجينا كل وحدة لها فترتها. تدون تعرفونها مكتوبة هي ما مطلوبة من عندكم عادة if it is more than 3 cm after 3 years if it is more than less than 3 cm the Barrett esophagus the length مالته usually after 10 years فلو طبعا لازم lifestyle modification لازم treatment with BBI okay if the patient develop dysplasia يعني وياها dysplasia presence of dysplasia this is an indication for endoscopic treatment يعني إذا أجتنا result Barrett esophagus اللي هي intestinal metabolism with dysplasia this is an indication for endoscopic treatment. What the modality of endoscopic treatment? We have photodynamic therapy, we have radio frequency ablation, we have cryotherapy. But the best is that of radio frequency ablation. What are the complications of treatment? عادة is an intentional. هي الفكرة شنو؟ البارت ميوكوزة أو ديسبليزيا نحرقها. نحرقها إما بالكرايو يعني شيء بارد أو راديو فريكوانسي ابليجن اللي هي شرارات أو فوتو دايناميك ثيرابي اللي هو ليزر. But what do you think the complication ممكن تنتج عنها؟ Long term complication. فشي جاي تحرقها يعني Stricture, stenosis, obstruction. هذا long term. صير ممكن ستركتشر. The best result is that of radio frequency ablation. فشكوا عندنا طبعا على sessions جلسات. The best is that of radio frequency ablation. We start to ablate all the dysplastic lesion and all the metaplastic lesion. And after we do ablation, we must do follow up, surveillance or ablation. يعني مثلا إذا واحد عنده low grade dysplasia, نقول له يجينا معكين وراء فترة عادينا 3 to 5 years. إذا high grade dysplasia كانت الرزالت مالتنا يجينا after usually after 6 months to 1 year. Another modality for treatment is surgery. And what are the indications of surgery in a patient with varices of oesophagus? What do you think? If the patient, he does not want to follow up. Follow up يراد لفترة تنبيتهم بعيد. هنا يعني العراق صغير مثلا بالهند ولايات بعيدة مثلا ولاية عن ولاية إذا يريد يسافر لازم يجمع فلوس يلا يروح للولاية سناتر ما تلجي اي تي ما موجودة في كل مكان لذا يعني ممكن يختار surgical بفضل مرة واحدة وهاي هي يعني if the patient does not want to go long term follow up surveillance one if the patient develop invasive carcinoma this is an indication for treatment surgical treatment. And what is the modality of surgical treatment? Is that of esophagectomy. Esophagectomy, it will ablate any metaplastic, dysplastic lesion and will ablate the need for follow-up surveillance. The other complication of GERD, anemia. And what do you think the cause of anemia? Well, esophagitis. يصير ulceration ويصير occult bleeding فممكن يصير iron deficiency anemia either because of the presence of hiatus hernia hiatus hernia تصعد فوق ال gastroesophageal junction والdiaphragm فممكن شنو ischemic necrosis ويصير ulcer بالنيك مات الهياتس هرنيا يسمونه cameron ulcer a cameron ulcer it is labile wall bleeding فممكن patient يصير anemia either other not related to GERD مثلا واحد عمره هو 60 سنه وعنده GERD symptom وانيميا ومو مو سبب الانيميا يعني الكاميرا ولا اسوفجايتس ممكن السبب مالتشن وممكن يكون other مثلا colorectal cancer فكاميرون ألسا اسوفجايتس other causes not related to GERD like colorectal cancer other causes of esophagitis important simply infection infectious esophagitis very important in immune compromised patient like AIDS patients patient taking the steroid those on immune suppressive treatment chemotherapy and the most important is candida esophagitis CMV esophagitis cytomegalovirus esophagitis and herpes simplex virus esophagitis كل واحد دي microscopic finding كل pathological finding ما مطلوب عندكم الأذر is corrosive material يعني مثلا دول اسمي شلون يصير corrosive material أطفال أو mentally retarded يشرب مثلا يلقى بطل أو كل شيء household bleach هذا اللي نظفون به الحمامات this is very dangerous يعني ممكن يشرب يصير esophagitis يصير مثلا عندهم تحديد long term complication ممكن يصير perforation bleeding medicinitis and death زين والإنسان مثلا العاقل مثلي ومثلكم شلون يصير عندك corrosive esophagitis logical نعم لا لا هو يشربه inhalation يروح لل شو اسمه يعني للرسبيراتوري مو inhalation هو يشرب شلون لا لا corrosive material corrosive material شنو نقصد بيها ال household bleach هاي المنظفات او مثلا الباتري مع السياره اللي هو باتري substances تأتينا الباتري مع السيارة يخلون دول يشتغلون بالباتريات يغيثون الباتري مع السيارة What do you think? Logica. ما بيش ليش يشرب من الأشياء. Suicide. More. Suicide. But most common cause of corrosive material ingestion هو either mentally retarded مو بعقله يشرب يشرب أي شيء قدامه عطشان هو ما يشرب ما يبطل يشرب أو طفل نفس الشيء يشرب أي شيء حتى حاجه يشرب أوكي والعاقل suicide أوكي يريد ينتحر يعني يشرب corrosive material a lot of complications disasters drugs important medication a lot of medication but at the top is antibiotic doxycycline tetracycline from that of other treatment used for osteoporosis which we call bisphosphonate and indranate and other substances the iron supplements we hear ferrous sulfate added and ممكن يسوي esophagitis vitamin c ممكن يسوي esophagitis liver how we prevent it لازم ناخذها واحنا قاعدين نشرب وياها جلاس ماي كامل وننتظر على الاقل نص ساعه الى ساعه يلا ننام عادة اكو شيء يسوي يجيب الحبايه ويبلعها بلع بدون ماي فوين تصير ستك بالايسوفيجاس هذا تايب اوف كونستركشن مناطق تضيقات نورمال بالايسوفيجاس منطقه وجود الاواصيه منطقه وجود الكراينه ديفوريكتيشن اوف ذا برونكاي كاسروسوفيجال جنكشن من تعلق هنا وهي تبدي تشتغل يعني دايركت توكسيسيتي او ريليس اوف سبستانسز تبدي تصير عندها ايسوفيجايتس Other very important is eosinophilic esophagitis. Eosinophilic esophagitis it is a special entity. It is an autoimmune and it is an endoscopic and histopathological diagnosis. Method biopsy from the esophagus. This is the histopathology. By histopathology, presence of eosinophil more than 15 per high power field. This is an eosinophilic esophagitis. And if it is an autoimmune, so what do you think the treatment? Treatment is that of inhalational and that of swallowing corticosteroid. هذا الستيرويد يأخذون يسمونه ميتر دوز انهيلر يخليه في حلقه بس بدل ما يستنشق ايش يسوي؟ يبلعه يروح للإسوفيجاس. اوكي؟ ممكن هو يصير يعني بالاندوسكوبيك فايندينج وي هاف ا لوت اوف فايندينج ما يسوي باروز او يسوي رينز او يسوي ستريتشر هذا يوزن الإسوفيجاس لازم يتعبوه مهم. The presentation of eosinophilic esophagitis. Then very important in the presentation, the patient عادة هو عند حفلة أو كل شيء هو young يأكلون لحم يسمونه يعني house steak يسمونه بالبيت ويبلع هذا عادة ما يستوي زين المضغة هو ويبلع يصير obstruction the most common of what we call house steak syndrome is eosinophilic esophagitis. House steak syndrome is our eosinophilic esophagitis. Motility disorders of the esophagus. The motility disorders of the esophagus, a lot of, one of it is Zinker diverticulum. There is simply, there is a diverticulum in the esophagus. It's a congenital type, and it is an acquired type. The food will collect in this diverticulum, and the patient will develop regurgitation. The other important is the achalasia. Achalasia is failure of relaxation of the lower esophageal sphincter. Normally because of loss. Of the normal neurons in the lower part of the esophagus responsible for relaxation of the lower esophageal sphincter. And it's bad in the lower esophageal sphincter. It will eat the mariyo, shway shway yaabdor, it's dilatation, it's jamma' food, it's the chest pain, burning chest pain, dysphagia is the cardinal symptom. The cardinal symptom of achalasia is the development of dysphagia to solid and liquid substances from the start. And how we diagnose esophagus, we do a barium, we show a dilatation of the esophagus. We do a manometry of the esophagus. In the manometry of the esophagus, we show failure of relaxation of the lower esophageal sphincter, raise the pressure in the lower type of the esophagus. Endoscopy important to exclude pseudoachalasia or secondary type of achalasia. Treatment simply. Either endoscopic treatment, we do dilatation, balloon dilatation of this part of the achalasia, or we have surgical. The surgical here other than laparoscopic, some hilar myotomy. Okay? Well, achalasia is a motility disorder, dysphagia to both solid and liquid from the start. The cardinal diagnosis is manometry. Okay? Admit يسموها secondary causes of achalasia, not because of motility disorder of the esophagus. عادةً connective tissue disease اللي هي infiltration. مثلاً dermatomyositis in upper part of the esophagus. حماك الاسophagus يتخلق على ممكن in the food to the stomach. أو in the lower part of the esophagus. مثلاً scleroderma, the muscle replaced by a fibrous. حماك يصير نحسب الكيوب ما يتبقى يعني emptying the food to the lower part of the stomach. Other important is the development of esophagitis, replacement of the muscle type of the esophagus with a fibrous tissue. Rheumatoid arthritis, يعني the secondary type of achalasia, mainly connective tissue disease, scleroderma, rheumatoid arthritis. Other, اللي هي يسمونها dermatomyositis, and important is esophagitis. And important is pseudoachalasia. What is pseudoachalasia? The lower part of the esophagus is infiltrated usually by a tumor. Next in the lower esophageal sphincter will not relax to empty the esophageal content to the stomach. This is mainly شلون نعرف هذه patient old age and a significant weight loss and then يعني anemia, gastrointestinal bleeding, hematemesis, melena, and the very important is the weight loss. Weight loss, usually rapid weight loss. يعني less than 6 months, the patient would lose weight. While a patient with achalasia, there is a long-term weight loss. يعني ممكن weight loss ما توقف لسنوات يبي شوي شوي. Gradually, يلا يصير عنده significant weight loss. وبالسيدوأكاليزيا, because of infiltrating the tumor at the cardiac, whether it is from the stomach or it is a metastatic type of tumor, from breast, from colon, from oncogenic carcinoma, this will cause tight lower esophageal sphincter and there will be significant weight loss. Tumor of the esophagus, simply we have benign and malignant tumor of the esophagus. Benign tumor, usually the most common is leiomyoma, other tumor of the esophagus, lipoma, fibrovascular bolus, and the patient usually presented either with advanced and it is a closed esophagus, so it will present with dysphagia or food induction, or it will develop chest pain and regurgitation. But the most important is dysphagia. Malignant tumor of the esophagus, two types, adenocarcinoma and squamous cell carcinoma. Adenocarcinoma is usually a complication of what? GERD, Barrett esophagus, adenocarcinoma. The risk factor for adenocarcinoma has the same risk factor of that of GERD. While squamous cell carcinoma, where is usually a squamous cell carcinoma? In the upper two-thirds of the esophagus, usually, but it can occur in any part of the esophagus. Squamous cell carcinoma, what are the risk factors for squamous cell carcinoma, do you think? Here, other causes than type of adenocarcinoma. The most important is smoking, cigarette smoking, corrosive material. يعني واحد مثلا الصغرى شارب corrosive material ممكن يصير squamous cell carcinoma in the future. Then smoking is an important risk factor for development of both adenocarcinoma and squamous cell carcinoma, but it's most common with squamous cell carcinoma. While alcohol, it is not a risk factor for that of adenocarcinoma, not like this one. It's a risk factor just for squamous cell carcinoma. This is unimportant. Okay? Treatment or diagnosis, usually diagnosis with a traditional diagnosis, either imaging, usually CT or MRI of the lower part of the chest, or endoscopy diagnosis, we take a biopsy and send for histopathological diagnosis. Treatment, a lot of modality. It is an early non-invasive. The curative is esophageal, and if it is advanced and it is non-curable, usually treated with radio chemotherapy. Thank you very much. I hope you learned something in the esophagus. You need to read the lecture. You need to revision of this treatment. And all these cardinal symptoms, it will take a lot of time from you in the medicine. Medicine is an important need, a lot of reading. I hope you will do excellent job with you this year.